Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, the world's most important amateur radio television program
on
the
internet. Second most important.
Amateur Logic TV is the most important amateur radio program on the internet.
So, will this ever make the internet?
Not likely.
Okay. It sounded good anyway.
And also,
PhasingLine Podcast, the most important.
I've heard that rumor.
And we are at the Dayton Hamvention in the beautiful Greene County Fairgrounds, Xenia, Ohio. Let's see, before we get started with today's show, well, the show is going to be about RTL-SDR, and we will tell you what that is in just a moment. Well, our guest will tell you what that is. I don't know much. Do you know what it is?
I know a little bit, but you definitely know a lot more.
That's right.
Yep. So we'll get to that in just a second, but first we have to do the pitch. Grab Arvin over there.
Yeah.
Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. I don't know who brings you the Phasing Line podcast.
You bring us the Phasing Line podcast, too.
So, hamradionow.tv, and you'll find Arvin there. We brought him here to the Hamfest, and you can feed the pig, Arvin.
PhasingLinePodcast.com, click the donate button, give us some love. We appreciate it.
So we will fight over the money that comes in.
Yes.
Okay. RTL-SDR, our guest is Carl Laufer. Where are you from, Carl?
I'm from Auckland in New Zealand.
So you, I think you get the farthest traveled because you just can't get any farther away.
Yep, that's right. About 20 hours of flight time.
Direct flight?
Not a direct flight. LAX to Dallas-Fort Worth to here.
and then Auckland to LAX.
Auckland to LAX,
which is what, 14, 15 hours?
About 12 hours.
Not bad.
Yeah, they gave you peanuts?
Yeah, no, we got a full meal.
Really?
And some pretzels.
Are you here just for the ham? Just for the Hamvention?
Yeah. I've been invited by TAPR.
Mm-hmm.
So,
you can do any other traveling around, or just get right back on the plane when this is over?
Yeah, Sunday evening, 6 p.m. I leave again.
So,
okay. Oh, wow.
So you presented at the TAPR forum? Or?
Yep. Yesterday morning in the TAPR forum, I did a little presentation about the RTL-SDR. Just a bit of an introduction to it.
Next up, we have Carl Laufer from Auckland, New Zealand, to talk to us about RTL-SDR dongles.
So hello everyone, my name is Carl, and I'm just going to give you a little introduction to the RTL-SDR today, which is basically an ultra-cheap software-defined radio.
RTL-SDR is a cute little cheap software-defined radio receiver dongle that plugs into a computer, and I've been hearing the name a lot. But I don't know very much about them. And then listening to you in the TAPR conference, it appears that what you did was refine them.
That's right.
So talking to a very general ham audience, you know, without all of the chops that the TAPR guys have,
right?
Where did this start and what did you do to it?
Well, this started about 4 years ago. This was when I first bought an RTL-SDR. Basically, I saw a post on Reddit. It made it to the front page, and I didn't even know what an RTL-SDR was, but people were getting excited about it. So I decided to buy one, and it took about 2 months to arrive. And when I got it, I forgot that I even ordered it.
it was cheap, right?
Yeah, it was the cheapest one you could get, about 10 USD.
Yep.
So I plugged it in, and instantly I was amazed, because suddenly I could see the radio signals, and this was pretty much the first type of radio that I ever purchased.
So the target for an RTL-SDR, they're not designed for hams, right?
No.
So they're TV tuners, right? Wasn't that the additional?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah. They're basically TV tuners that some software hackers have basically figured out how to turn them into a wideband SDR.
And it's a category, right? It's not just
There's many different types of RTL-SDRs now. Back then, there was just the DVB-T tuners, but now people have figured out that they're quite popular for SDR use.
I guess we should mention that you're not a ham, as you said, yet.
No. Yeah, well, after this, maybe.
Kind of getting interested. Yeah. So what was your background?
I studied electrical engineering in Auckland University. Oh, well, computer engineering. After that, I started my PhD in machine learning, and during that PhD, I started up that blog, rtl-sdr.com. And just as I was finishing up my PhD, the blog started to become more and more popular. So right now, I'm mainly doing the blog.
That's your job?
Yep.
Pretty good job. So you got this RTL dongle and right. plugged it in, and what the first one that you got, the cheapest one that you could get, mm-hmm. what did it do?
Well, basically, the first thing I saw was broadcast FM, and then that's when all those years of DSP schooling in university kind of just clicked. Then that's like
so. Yeah. Back when you're going, where am I ever going to use this?
Exactly.
Here yeah. you are.
Oh,
yeah.
So you plug it into a computer.
All right.
You run some software, custom software, freeware.
Yep, all free.
All right. Yep. And it provides demodulation. You could hear it through the speakers.
Exactly.
Also
yes.
a waterfall
yeah.
and other displays.
Spectrum analyzer, yeah.
So you had not been a radio guy.
No.
Up till that
no.
point.
No. Computers. I mean, I'd known about radio from electrical engineering school. You know,
yeah.
DSP courses and stuff, but that's
so,
about it.
So these things typically go pretty high in frequency, not very low into the low bands, radio bands, right?
Well, the ones that are most popular now, they go down to about 24 megahertz.
Yeah.
Up to about 1.7 gigahertz or so. But the one I'm selling now, I've actually modified it to go down to HF as well.
So is there like an up converter in it or something?
Well, there's two ways to do it. You can use an up converter, right? So you pay more for purchasing an up converter. Or the method I've used is direct sampling mode. So basically on those chips that are used inside the dongles, there's an unused ADC. And I basically just connected up the antenna signal to that unused ADC. And that makes the HF bands available.
So that's something they didn't use in the satellite deal because of the television receiver. They didn't need it.
Right.
Right, yeah.
But it was there.
Yeah.
Why was it there?
Basically, it's just the way that the chip works. Some dongles use an E4000 tuner chip, mm-hmm. which is a chip that basically has the INQ outputs coming out of that chip going into the ADC. But then there's another one called the RA20T chip, which only has only needs one ADC.
Yeah.
And so the IQ data is then created in software.
So that's where you have the extra.
Yeah. So there's one left over then. It's unused.
As far as receiver performance, how does that vary between the different chips?
RA20T is probably the better chip. E4000 does go a bit higher in frequency. That can go up to, I think it was something over 2 gigahertz. The RF performance of the RA20 seems to be a bit better than the E4000.
So they're 8-bit, or are they?
Yes, the ADC, the RTL-2832U ADC, is 8 bits. Yeah.
So the first receiver that you got was interesting.
Yeah.
You played with it a while.
Yeah.
Took a while, a short time, I imagine, until you realized its shortcomings?
Yep.
And what were the shortcomings?
Basically,
is it a piece of crap?
It wasn't a piece of crap, but it had its limitations.
But it's only $10.
Yeah, $10. I mean, yeah.
So I'm wondering how good a receiver these are at that price.
Yeah. So basically, the problems were things like frequency drift, interference from out of band signals, lots of spurs, and things like this.
So listening to FM broadcast stations, that wasn't a big deal.
Yeah, no deal. No,
so what did you
that.
Start to try to listen to after you realized it had far more capability?
Okay, so things like trunking channels.
Is there software that will support following trunks and whatnot?
Yes, it's called Unitrunker. If you want to follow trunking, you need two dongles. Of course, one to listen to the control channel and one to listen to the voice channels. Also moved on to digital signals like DMR, P25. Tetra, and then of course there's things like ADS-B and NOAA satellites.
Those are in higher frequencies. The ADS-B is about what, 1025 megahertz?
1090 megahertz. Yeah.
So when you started your blog, were you still working on this first version of the radio that you got, or?
No, I started the blog first. I wasn't really expecting it to get very big. It was just kind of more like just like notes to myself and tutorials that I wanted to write.
Yeah, here's something cool I found, and anybody else finds this, maybe you'll like it.
Yeah.
Right. And so it was cool, but it had limitations.
Yeah.
And so what did you do?
So about 2 years after running the blog, and listening to people talk about the dongles on on Reddit and forums and stuff, I sort of had a good grasp of what was wrong with the generic dongles. So I decided to use my blog as a platform to launch a business selling my own dongles. And what I've done now is I'm working with the Chinese manufacturers, and I've basically just used them to help me improve the dongle and produce a better dongle for SDR people or radio people who want to use these as actual SDRs and not just for TV.
Yeah. Now, that's sort of an interesting story all by itself. Start dealing with Chinese manufacturers to build you stuff. I've heard...
Probably read a book on it.
I've heard other stories from the TAPR guys where they reach out to vendors in China.
Yeah.
How do you make a contact like that, and how do you negotiate what the product is going to be?
Well, basically, I got my contact first by just ordering the generic dongles and selling them on the blog. And then slowly, as I gained more profit and experience dealing with them, my orders started getting larger and larger. And at that point, you start getting good contacts with the Chinese manufacturer. And then, of course, when I talked about improving them, they were more than receptive to my ideas.
Was the communication very direct?
Oh, yeah, very direct.
You just call them on the phone, Skype them or something?
Yeah, maybe Skype and email, yeah.
Yeah. And English good, and or is there much of a language barrier?
No, English is fine. Yeah, I mean, there's some funny English, but you can really understand it. Yeah,
and they're happy to do business and eager to work with somebody who's going to distribute their product.
They want your skill and experience.
Yeah.
I guess so. So you gave them engineering or just ideas
Well, I gave them. I designed the circuit. They gave me basically a picture of the PCB. They wouldn't give me the PCB files. They just gave me a picture. And then I just started drawing in the picture, saying, oh, this should go here, and I want to put a TCXO here, so put the pads for that here, et cetera, like that. And over time, and many revisions of images being sent back and forth, it kind of evolved.
So you ended up with a version of the RTL-SDR. What do you call yours?
I'm up to version 3 now. I just call it V3.
So what is different?
Okay, so first, the main difference is probably the TCXO. The regular dongles just have a normal, 100 ppm oscillator. This TCXO has good temperature stability. It's got a metal case, of course, for
shielding.
For shielding. I've added things, extra features like a bias T, so you can power like a remote LNA over the coax line, or it's sometimes called phantom power. Of course, I added the HF circuit as well. So you can access HF via direct sampling. Also redesigned the PCB a bit to get rid of some spurs, et cetera, like that, and lower the noise floor. Oh, and also got rid of that annoying MCX connector, which
no ham wants.
Yeah, exactly, and put a SMA connector on it.
So what is the average use when somebody buys your SDR? Yep. What are most people, especially at the show here, hams kind of using them?
Okay. Well, I did a poll on my website once, and I found that the biggest use of these dongles is for ADS-B, and secondly, for monitoring digital communications like P25, DMR, and trunking.
So they're really not meant for HF, I guess.
No.
But you can listen on HF, put a good antenna on it.
Now, up converter or direct
sampling. The concerns that I've had, and I don't know if these people were talking about your particular version or just the cheap ones, was that they overload easily. So yours will still overload.
Yeah, I mean, it's still 8-bit, so it does have a lot of limitations in that regard, but you can fix that with filtering.
So there's no internal BPFs or anything like that?
No.
But you can add external stuff ahead
external,
of it,
which probably
costs 10 times the price. So you've boosted your product up to the astronomical cost of what?
$20 about.
So you doubled the price.
Yeah, and $25 with antennas.
Yeah. So if we were talking about an ICOM or a Flex radio and said, well, we doubled the price, that would be something. But
so
from $10 to $20.
The cheapest Japanese or, I guess, big American SDR on the market is in the $1,000 range. But if for...
I think the Wind radios and stuff get cheaper than that, but a little bit.
Right.
But they're still hundreds of dollars compared to $20.
$20. Anybody can have a radio for $20. There's not a ham in this ham fest that cannot afford a $20 radio.
Yeah, and for HF, it's a good station monitor.
Yeah, exactly.
It gives you a spectrum analyzer on your HF station. You can see what you look like.
I see a lot of people using them. They tap the IF in their radios and then use them as pan adapters.
Pan adapters, yes. Yeah. That's another popular use.
Right. Yep. So your market, are hams a significant percentage of it?
I would say so. I think the bigger market is probably more of the electronics enthusiasts, like makers and people like that.
So let's talk a little bit about the receiver performance across kind of it's you said it goes from 2 gigs, you said, to
24 megahertz to about 1.7 gigahertz, and HF mode 500 kilohertz up to 24 megahertz.
But it's not continuous. You can't be...
It's continuous. Yeah.
But how much bandwidth can you see at a time? How wide?
Stably, you can see up to 2.4 megahertz. Mm-hmm. Unstably, if you don't mind, some packet drops up to 3.2 megahertz.
Okay, so it's not as wide as the Flex.
But it's $20.
It's $20. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. I mean, I don't have one yet, but I can't think of any reason why any ham wouldn't want to have one. Where do you find your blog?
RTL-SDR.com.
That's very generic.
Yeah, yes. Very creative. Points for creativity.
No one else thought to get that first.
It's a good keyword for Google, though.
Do you
come up first in all the searches, I guess.
So let's talk software for a minute, because...
Right.
This isn't just hardware.
Yeah.
This is SDR after all. So do you use a special software? Does it use the kind of the standard stuff out there as far as like SDR Sharp and HDSDR and stuff?
Yeah,
like
SDR
that?
Sharp, HDSDR, SDR console on Linux and Mac, GQRX, things like that.
Do you have a favorite? Different things for different uses.
For Windows I prefer SDR Sharp. Mm-hmm. And of course Linux and Mac, you gotta use GQRX.
SDR Sharp will run on Linux, right?
Sometimes.
Sort of, kind of.
Sometimes. I mean, yeah, depending on the version and what you have installed and stuff like that, it's quite difficult to make it work.
I'm still kind of blown away that this is a business, full-time business.
Yeah.
How long will this thing have legs?
I don't know, as long as...
as you can milk it.
Yeah.
Do you have plans for product improvement? Maybe product diversity?
Yeah, I'm... working on mainly things like accessories now for RTL dongles, bandpass filters.
So here's my question. If you start with this $20 SDR receiver, mm-hmm. by the time you have, if people wanted to build a kind of, I envision an ecosystem sort of around based around that,
right.
If that's what you're getting at, where mm-hmm. if you have BPFs and LNAs
yep.
and all that stuff, that ends up being significantly more money than the receiver itself.
Right? Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, not significantly. I mean, like, the filters I'm selling are about $15.
Are you suggesting you raise the price of the receiver to make the accessories look better?
No. I mean, I think it's so cool that you can have an HF radio, a VHF radio, and anything radio, a DC to daylight radio for $20. Mm.
Yeah. I mean, again, when I first encountered the notion of it and the price, I was thinking, well, this is going to be a total piece of crap. Why would anybody want one? Well, so yeah, it's got limitations, but it is way better than what you would seem to be able to get for $20. So the guys that have done this, especially the guys that have bought yours, are way ahead of the game. The rest of us are just kind of sitting around here being dumb, because why not? You know what?
So in software, you can go in, obviously, it'll do any sort of analog mode. I assume there's software for digital modes. Can it decode modes that, you know, we typically think of we need hardware for, like D-Star, for example, where you need a vocoder typically for, like, a word?
There's a version of DSD, digital speech decoder, that can actually decode D-Star.
So you don't need an ambi vocoder?
Yeah.
No, it's just the software that does it.
How do they get around the licensing deal?
Yeah.
I'm not sure how they get around the licensing for that. It's open source software, so I'm not too sure. I think you have to download the codec separately or something like that.
They haven't figured out who to sue yet.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
If it's open source, who do you blame? If it's a bunch of people working on it, what do you...
Yeah. And P25?
Yeah, P25, phase one.
DMR.
You can do phase two, but that software is a bit more complicated to set up. It's called OP25.
Do people ever use these as like receivers for satellite work?
Especially weather satellites, you know, like NOAA and Russian Meteor M N2 satellites.
Yeah, and that may be the first place I heard it. It was the Satnagus guys that we were looking at their booth. Oh, yeah. They use RTL-SDRs for their satellite receivers for their ground station network.
He's probably at VHF.
So you know those guys?
Well, I don't know them, but I've blogged about them, and I've met them some of them today.
Okay, they're here. So.
They're here, yeah. So at VHF and UHF, the receivers are probably ample for just about 99.999% of anything a ham's doing.
I think so, yeah.
Yep. Well, once you get up there, then sensitivity becomes
more of an issue.
Do you have a decent sensitivity at VHF, UHF?
It's decent, but once you get to things like L-band, there's some projects you can do on L-band at 1.5 gigahertz, receiving satellites at that range, then you'll need an LNA.
Am I hearing thunder? Thought I heard a clap of thunder.
I think we're hearing rain. We're in the how is finding us? I mean, we're at the end of Tent City.
I got lost trying to find you guys.
we're kind of
don't blame you.
In the back 40.
I ran into Mike Osman on the way here, and he pointed me in the right direction.
Oh, well, cool.
So I guess people know where we are.
You knew where we were. Yeah. That's awesome.
I guess we're that cool.
TAPR invited you to come here. Did you have a clue as to what it was you were coming to?
To some extent, I guess.
Have you been to the States before?
Not really. A long time ago when I was a kid, but I can't really remember.
He's still a kid. He may be older than you, but he's still a kid.
Have you been to a ham radio event before?
No.
So what do you think of all these hams?
Well, they're great. I mean, there's a lot of variety here.
Most people, because I don't know if people have explained, the Hamfest moved from a very dilapidated convention center to a nice
fairgrounds,
but kind of overgrown fairgrounds for this activity because of these tents. So we can't ask you what you think of the difference. No. But
what do you think of the place?
Oh, it's fine. Yeah.
You've probably been to conferences and stuff. Technical conferences.
Probably far nicer than this.
Yeah, in expensive hotels, which is where TAPR usually shows up. They do their digital conference.
The DCC,
and that's in a nice hotel, well air conditioned, sometimes overly air conditioned. What kind of stuff do you do back in New Zealand? This has become your full time job.
Yeah. So, you mean before I started this full time?
Yeah. So you didn't start doing this right out of college.
No, I started this sort of near the end of my PhD when I was starting to think about writing my thesis.
So what did you do between? Were you working? See, were you working on this while you were working on? So was this your thesis, or is your thesis?
No, my thesis was something
completely different.
Completely unrelated.
So you're not working in your originally chosen field. This is not what you wanted to be when you grow up.
Yeah.
So are you using your PhD, or are they just cool letters to have after your name?
Well, the good thing about a PhD is it's taught me how to think. I think. Right.
Three very expensive letters.
Yeah. I guess that's what school is really all about. It's not teaching how to. It's not vocational so much as teaching.
It's taught me that you can do anything if you put your mind to it. Right.
Yeah. So you're the second PhD here that I've talked to.
Oh, okay. Who's the other one?
It's in that ham, CS.
HamSci?
HamSci.
Oh, right. From the ARRL.
I saw them.
Yeah. Yeah. So one of the guys there is
PhD. I don't really know what they're about. I don't know what they are, but I've seen them.
I was an amateur radio operator first. I got my ham license when I was in high school, and then I went to grad school, and I liked ham radio so much I got my PhD in ionospheric science, ionospheric physics. And I said, hey, this is really cool. Maybe we can actually learn something about the ionosphere and do studies using this reverse beacon network data.
They got a cool project coming up this summer when we have the eclipse.
Yeah,
you're not going to get this eclipse in New Zealand.
No,
not at all.
Yeah, sorry, got to come back. They're going to be looking for propagation anomalies during the eclipse.
Intriguing. So after all this, does ham radio interest you at all now?
Yeah. I think I'll probably work on my license within the next year or so.
It's got a PhD. The ham license should be about 15 minutes of study. I'm not sure what the requirements are in New Zealand, but they're probably similar.
You can probably walk across the street this afternoon and get an American license.
probably don't need
to study.
Could do.
Yep. I'm not sure what else to ask. You got something else you want to know, Marty?
Where my brain is going with this is kind of using them on HF. And I'm just trying to think, with hams and high power and lots of signals together, Let's talk a little bit about kind of its receiver performance.
It's not going to be a contest receiver, sorry. It won't be even your second receiver.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about its filtering, and especially with the software, kind of how well we can isolate signals and block another one.
Well, if it's in software, you know, software-defined radios, you can really isolate the signal quite easily in software. But yeah, if there's something overloading the receiver, then you'll need a tight filter or something like that.
Yeah.
I think the main problem is broadcast FM.
Yep.
That tends to overload things quite easily.
So you really need a bandpass filter for ACE.
Possibly. I mean, it depends if there's some guy next to you transmitting a lot.
Even the big SDRs will put filters in to get rid of the broadcast
stations. Yeah, they'll put in switchable.
Those signals are everywhere and they're huge.
And they're loud. So I have a friend who lives in the CX in Uruguay, however you pronounce it, and he has volts coming out of all of his antennas because he's on farmland 20 miles away from the 100 kW AM.
All of the SDR folks, of the direct sampling SDR folks, they'll put a little asterisk, you know, it's antenna, A to D converter, but antenna filter A to D.
How much protection is on the front end of it?
Static signal. Strong signals.
How hard is it to blow up?
Because we have transmitters.
It's pretty difficult to blow up. I don't really get many people who's telling me that they've blown them up. If it does blow up, it's probably a lot of static or something like that.
What kind of quality and quality control have you found dealing with the Chinese manufacturer?
Yeah, so the quality is all right. It's less than 1%, I think, from my statistics.
Do you check them all before they...
I can't because they go from China to America to like Amazon or to the logistics center. But I have made a QC control Raspberry Pi setup for the Chinese factory. So basically there's plug into the Raspberry Pi and there's a transmitter which transmits to the RTL, and the Raspberry Pi automatically checks certain things like frequency offset.
And so with that failure rate, if somebody gets a bad one, it's not a problem for you to replace it.
I just replace it, send a new one out.
And
you get the old
loss.
One back, and you get your scope out, and you start trying to find out what went wrong.
Oh, I don't even really ask for them back anymore.
Is there any one consistent thing that is a failure for them?
Not really, no.
So who knows, and then just throw it away and get another one.
Yeah.
At that cost, shipping is more expensive than the thing is worth.
Yeah. It still blows me away, $20. So everyone should have one.
Where can we get them?
Is anybody... RTL-SDR.com.
And we can buy them direct off the website?
For U.S. customers, they're on Amazon. So if you're a Prime member, free shipping. And I think it's over $35 or something, you get free shipping as well.
Yeah, you're all set.
And if you're international from China, I have a logistics warehouse that I use there to send them out.
So your design and improvements, and the Chinese manufacturers making them, is that exclusive to you? Is that protected, or can someone else grab them?
It's exclusive to me from that factory. But, of course, if another factory or someone decides to copy it, then you can't do it.
Yeah, or somebody else does some engineering on their own.
There's no patents here or anything like that.
No, nothing like that. No.
Yeah. Any competition moving in yet?
Not really. There's other companies selling similar things, too, but... I'm happy to share the market. I mean, it's a huge market,
I think. But yours is still the best
RTL-SDR
on the market.
I have to say that, yeah.
Yeah. He's got his fingers crossed underneath the table. I hope it is.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much for coming by. And,
no problem.
Have a great HamFest.
You don't have one yet, right?
What?
An RTL-SDR.
I do.
Oh, you do?
I don't have one of his. I probably should.
I should have brought some for you for free.
I'll come buy them.
We'll buy one.
Yeah.
$20. Come on. and we'll look for the accessories, and they'll be fun to play with.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Carl.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's been a blast.
And this is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now and
Phasing Line Podcast.
For Ham Radio Now, stop by hamradionow.tv and Arvin, standing by for your contribution.
For me, go to phasinglinepodcast.com. Click that donate button. PayPal works. Patreon works. Thank you so much. We really appreciate your support of the Phasing Line. Donation counts.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Marty Selloway, KC1CWF.
Over.
And out.
Wait, you took two words. I was supposed to get one back. Over.
And?
Out. Or over. No, you could say over.
Over.
And?
Out.
That just makes it even. We have to do the broadcast stuff.
Sorry?
We have to do the funny broadcast stuff.
Yes.
The audience expects it.
Yeah, of course.